Hello, everyone, and welcome to the stream. How are you doing tonight? My name is Wonder Goon. Mike, I'm getting some feedback. Hold on, from somewhere.
Okay.
Okay, there we go. I think that's good. I can no longer hear myself, so I'm happy. How are you all doing tonight? My name is Wonder Goon. With me, as always, is Kesadrith. Tonight's topic is the Midnight Stream of Nowhere is the name of the show. Tonight's topic is the Fermi Paradox. I'm confused because I have an Agent of Chaos in my arms. How are you doing, baby girl? All right, episode 26. Can you believe we're already to episode 26?
I cannot. It really doesn't seem like we've been doing things these things that long. It really doesn't.
I know, it's kind of crazy, but... It's been so much fun doing them, and I really appreciate you continuing to be here for them.
Oh, it's been a blast. So, you know, here's to 26 more, as far as I'm concerned. So.
Heck yeah, thanks. as always, we are still supporting Rain, so if you wish to donate !charity in the chat, and that will get you a link to Rain to donate. We are at 14%. We are going to be continuing to support them until the end of the month. I urge you to donate if you have the means to do so. It also, I just added this. As you know, I have a merchant store where you can get Wonder Goon products. You can get hats, shirts, mugs, and so forth, stickers and whatnot. If you are a Tier 1 subscriber, you get 10% off of all purchases through the merch store, !merch, for a link. If you are a Tier 2 subscriber, you get 20% off. And if you are a Tier 3 subscriber, you get 50% off. So if you want some cool-ass Wonder Goon swag, !merch in the chat or in the About section down below, there's a link for that. Okay, Dahlia Ahane, I'm going to put you down. Thank you, sweetheart. Okay. How are you doing today, Kesadrith?
I'm doing all right. Got some writing done. Got some just actually, I didn't get much else done. Got some writing done. Watched some videos. Played some Eve. Mm-hmm. What could be better, you know?
Yeah, that exactly. Sort of yeah, that sounds like a good day.
Heck yeah.
anything? Hello again, baby girl. God, she just won't stay away from me. Anything significant coming up that we should be on the lookout for from you?
Oh, not for me. Like I said, I've kind of fallen behind on doing any of the streaming or anything like that. You know, I had a few fans that maybe I've let them down. I don't know. But with the move and everything, I just lost the groove and I haven't picked it back up. So I've got nothing going on in that regard. So sorry.
No, that's okay. Hopefully you'll get back into it. I really enjoyed your Skyrim streams. So and your right. Hero System streams for that matter. So I enjoyed those.
I definitely would mind picking that one back up because I left it on. I could do a second part on the Western Hero for sure.
Oh, that heck yeah, that'd be fun. earlier in one of our streams, we talked about the Aurora Borealis. Was there any reaction from the University of North Dakota of our using their stream on stream?
Not a thing.
No,
so
no one said anything.
Nope.
Did you show it to them?
I wasn't quiet about it, I'll put it that way, but a lot of the professors and everything there are not exactly 100% the most I say this and it sounds amazing given their physics professors, but they're not the most tech savvy and social media savvy individuals on the face of the earth. So
gotcha. That doesn't bode well for the future of physics in North Dakota.
Yeah, and you when you've got two of the others that occasionally post images, or if not the link to the live stream for the North Dakota Aurora Cam, I wasn't all that concerned that there would be an upset hue and cry about us doing the same thing. Okay. So,
well, hopefully there'll be no negative repercussions and they enjoyed right. The free publicity. So
there you go. So, you know, and by the way, any of you thinking of majoring out there in physics or astrophysics, do take into consideration and think about University of North Dakota. And maybe that'll unruffle any fur.
Okay. Fair enough. All right, tonight's topic, as we said before, is the Fermi paradox. Let's get into it, shall we?
Sure, let's do this. To me, it's one of the most fun topics out there, both science and science fiction, to be honest.
Okay.
So, I got a nice PowerPoint slide here. You know, Fermi paradox. And I guess the best place to start is the next thing that should pop up, which is, it's named for the famous physicist Enrico Fermi. He was an Italian-American physicist. He's the gentleman who gave us nuclear reactors. And he, in a discussion with some friends of his one time at Los Alamos, they got into a discussion about where are the aliens? If they're out there, if they're like us, why haven't we heard from them? If they're more advanced than us, why haven't we seen them? And that was a big question between this Nobel Prize winning gentleman and a few of his colleagues. We've got all this going on. We do. Mm-hmm. If anybody else is out there doing the same thing, why haven't we seen them? Or where are they?
According to legend, so he asked this question over a sandwich at lunch.
That is the scuttlebutt, anecdotal story told. They were at lunch when the discussion started going, and he made some notes on a napkin, making some wild guesses, similar to what we're going to be doing tonight, to be honest. And not trying to say I'm a Nobel Prize winning scientist here, I am clearly not, but it's fun to do the same type of thing and think about, where are they? And so we're going to delve into that question a little bit. Right. And first place to start is always with, are they even out there? So that brings up this nice little thing that's often sneered about called the Drake equation. All the Drake equation is a statistical equation that tries to represent, give us a handle on just how many civilizations should be out there even. So here's the look at the equation. All of these are either numbers or fractions, which are numbers, duh. But but they tell us some information, and from left to right, they go from the most certain to the least certain, the most open-ended. And so getting into what they are, capital N is the number of civilizations transmitting. In other words, that's the number of civilizations like us that are emitting and communicating via radio waves. R star is the yearly formation rate of stars. So that's how many new stars are being formed in the galaxy per year. And that's a fairly easy number, as we'll discuss, to come up with. But now we start getting into the trickier stuff. What fraction of our star have planets? And that's a good question. How many of them are going to have planets? Because you can't exactly have life, as we know it anyway, without having a planet for it to form on. But then we get into the problem of just how many of those planets, even if they do have a planet. The next one is, how many of these planets are suitable for life to form on? In other words, how many of them are rocky? Because to date, we don't know that you can form life in a gas giant in the cloud layers. Is it possible? Maybe, maybe not. Who knows? We certainly haven't found it. So this gets into some of the speculation about this. What are the suitable planets? And how many of them are there per solar system? Then we get into the fraction of the planet, that number of planets, where life actually does appear. Because not all of them, again, as we'll discuss, not all of them are going to have life appear. Okay? So we've got a fraction of those, that N sub E, that are going to have life appear. Of that, there's only going to be a fraction of them that intelligent life develops on the planet. So that's what F sub I or FI is about. Then we're getting into the last few. And we've got F sub C, FC, which is the fraction that could communicate. In other words, the ones that, and for our interest, develop radio technology, develop the ability to communicate by it, and therefore a broadcasting in radio waves, which we could then pick up. And last but not least is L, which is the length of length of time in years that the civilization is communicating. And that's another big one that, well, hopefully you've been able to see that once we get to our star, the right-hand side of the equation, these numbers have gone from something I can definitively pin down and say, we know this one, to, by capital L, we don't even have a sample size of one for this yet. So we go from certain, fairly certain, or really certain, to we're spitballing here in a matter of just a few variables.
Okay.
But even the spitballing is very, very, very interesting. And that's what we get into next. So I figured, what the hey? Let's play around with this Drake equation a little bit and actually fit in some numbers that are reasonable. So the first one we're going to fit in is R star. And I chose a value of roughly 3 per year. Why? Because I went and looked it up in reputable papers and things like that. And a lot of them cluster around, there's roughly 3 solar masses worth of material being put into stars per year in our galaxy. Now, this doesn't mean 3 stars are being created, are being born. This means that 3 solar masses of stars are being created. Some of those stars are going to be much more massive than our sun, so they take up, one star might take up that whole 3 per year. But those stars aren't interesting for us because that would be an AO or AO or B class star, and even if those have planets, they're going to be scorched. The star is massive. It's giving off a lot of radiation, a lot of ultraviolet radiation in particular. Any planet around such a star is going to be scorched. They're rare anyway. Stars that size are very rare. So I kept it 3 per year as being a reasonable estimate because that'll include mainly F, G, and K stars with some M-type stars thrown in. So we're going to keep it at 3 per year and assume that all of them are sun-like stars that are being produced every year in our galaxy.
Okay.
So that brings up then, which fraction of those have planets? And I chose the figure of 1. Everywhere we are looking, we find planets. So we can statistically say with reasonable certainty now that every star out there in the roughly 200 to 300 billion stars in our galaxy alone, that there is a planet out there for every single one of those stars. And so that means the fraction that have planets is 1. Okay. So, you know, that's a fairly solid number now. Okay.
All right.
Now we start getting into the nebulous ones. Now we start getting into the ones where we can start discussing things and start playing around a little bit. And that is the number that are Earth-like, the number of those planets that are Earth-like in a solar system. And I chose a number of 1.3. Now, I will point out that this is a pessimistic number. That's what I was going to call it, a positive pessimistic, because it's positive in that it's greater than 1, because how many planets bearing life do we have in our solar system?
1. That we know of.
Right. And that's why it's positive in that we've got 5-6 possibilities: Venus, Mars, Enceladus, Europa, and Venus, Mars, Enceladus, Europa,
Titan.
Possibly Titan, possibly Ganymede, possibly Callisto. So that's like 7 worlds. Notice I don't necessarily say planets because some of those are moons. 7 worlds that potentially could harbor some kind of life. We have not, I must emphasize this, we have not found life on any of those other worlds yet. But for Enceladus and Europa, definitely the conditions are there. We know there's water. We know there's liquid water. We know there's salt in the case of Enceladus and Europa. Mm-hmm. So we've got a salty electrolytic soup on both of those worlds. And as far as we know, with a reducing atmosphere, that's what you need to get life kickstarted. So I was a little pessimistic, and I kept it at 1.3 instead of 7. But at the same time, I was a little, you know, was a little pessimistic, kept at 1.3 instead of 7. But I was a little positive in that instead of saying 1, which is all we can definitely say, I gave it 1.3. So there's all my justification and reasoning for there being a 1.3 in that position in the Drake equation. All right. So now we get into the fractions, the rest of the fractions. So FL, I chose, which is the fraction that have life appear on them of that NE. Okay. And I put that at 0.3. There I was pessimistic. We've had 1 out of 9 planets develop life. That's 1/3. So 0.33. Okay. So to me, there's not much fluctuation there, but maybe there is. Maybe life is about a bit more common than we're thinking. Maybe it's not quite as common, but we'll get into that discussion in a minute too. So continuing on to flesh this out, we've got FI. This is the fraction of these planets that they've developed. They're Earth-like. They develop life. 0.01. Or in other words, 1%, I'm saying it will develop intelligent life. Okay? Now, that is a complete crapshoot. I have a sample size of 1. Or do I? Do you consider dolphins and whales intelligent?
I do.
Okay. Then 0.01 may not be too far off the mark then, because there's several species that are intelligent. We've got the apes, the other great apes besides ourselves. Mm-hmm. We've got our ancestors, the various branches of hominids that came about. So maybe that fraction being 0.01 is not that far off. Maybe it is a very tiny fraction of species that developed that tool using ability that leads to FC.
I'd like to point out that there was, what, 6 hominid species on the planet at one point, or over the course of time. We're the only survivors, but there have been 5 other hominid species. And as far as we know, if it happens here, that there are 5 species develop on one planet, the chances are pretty good, I would think, and I may be wrong about this, that would happen on other planets as well. Does that follow?
That follows, and that's kind of what I'm getting at. This number is, for us, going to be really hard to put down. I put a pretty pessimistic value, 0.01. Mm-hmm. It could be higher. Intelligence, depending on how you want to define it, could be a fairly common occurrence. I don't think it's going to prove to be, and this is the other part that I wanted to get into about FI. The real reason I don't think intelligence is going to prove to be that common out in space when we get out there, mm-hmm. is because this little lump on top of our necks weighs about 3 pounds, and it burns about 1/3 of your calories per day. So if that does not provide some kind of serious survival advantage, a brain like ours is not going to develop. Just plain and simple. It's not biologically efficient. Mm-hmm. Okay? So I am just going to come down on the side that intelligence, beyond a certain point, is going to prove to be very, very rare. And so, again, I'll stand by my fraction of 0.01. It may be actually a little optimistic. But others may feel differently. It all depends on how you really think about these things. There are definitely other intelligent species that have developed. They have not developed the tool use that we have, but I can make arguments there as well. But anyway, that's FI.
All right.
Questions, comments, or dirty looks there?
Not for me.
Okay. So FC is how many of those intelligences develop radio communications? And I set that as a reasonably, what I consider a reasonably high fraction, 0.1. I could probably be talked into going as high as 0.8, because I think discovering radio waves and discovering that you can transmit information by them is going to be something that happens fairly readily, fairly easily, because we picked up on that idea back in the 1800s when people started playing around with magnets and realizing they could make sparks happen on a wire with a gap in it from across the room. So people picked up that you can transmit information fairly readily, fairly early on, once we started actually experimenting with the world and the natural world and trying to figure things out. So FC to me could be anywhere, is another crapshoot, but I'm going to say it's at least 0.1. Chances are it could be higher. They're going to develop, radio communications. So to me, FC is going to be, I could be talked into giving it a bit higher, but we'll leave it at 0.1 for right now.
Okay.
All right. And then comes L. This is the lifetime that the civilization is transmitting. I gave that a length of 500 years. Now, here's the problem with that, this variable. And it's not the one that most people come up against. Most people immediately jump to, that's how long the civilization lasts. It's only 500 years. No. Because here's the deal. We've only been transmitting radio signals for about 100 years, a little less. All right? But we're already went from radio black to radio bright, and we're back to radio dark. By that, I mean our radio signals, when we first started transmitting radio and television signals, were omnidirectional. We broadcast them, just blew them out of those towers in all directions. That's why they had to be fairly powerful. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Their energy was being broadcast in all directions. Nowadays, our energy from our transmitters is being beamed pretty much in cones that stick fairly close to the area right around the tower, or it's being beamed directly up to a specific satellite and then beamed back down to Earth, or it's being transmitted via fiber optic cable, you know, and pulses of laser light. So we've gone from being broadcasting just an inordinate amount of information about us out into space with these omnidirectional transmitters, where now we're pretty dark again, actually, because we're no longer blowing it out all over the place. We're sending it where we want it to go. So L, if you look at it from that way, doesn't mean the civilization died. It just means they've gone too dark for us to see. And if we're any indicator on that, that could be as little as 100 years or 80 years, even. Or if you want to view it as the lifetime of the civilization, that they'll always be printing out radio waves until they something happens that they are destroyed in some fashion, then this is a completely open-ended variable, and all of a sudden it could be 1,000 years, it could be 40 years, it could be whatever you want. So I chose a nice little variable of 500 to plug into this equation, this Drake equation, and see what the result came out to be. And that comes next. And so, bam, there we have it. Bottom line, what this says is that with my with my variables, we should be it, because there's only going to be 0.6 civilizations with that meet this criteria at any one time.
Mm-hmm.
So we're it. Well, that's no fun. But what if, like I said, FC is 0.8 instead of 0.1? That means I basically multiplied that variable by 8, which is going to multiply that whole equation by 8, and all of a sudden, let's see, 8 times 6 is what, 48?
Mm-hmm.
Now all of a sudden there's 4.8 of those civilizations around. So we're one of 4.8, one of 5. Okay, What if L is longer? What if L is 1,000? That's a nice long time, 1,000 years. Well, that only multiplies it by 2, but that still means there's 1.2. Taken together, it's all of a sudden, it's 0.6 times 2 is 1.2 times 8 is 1699.6. Oh, so that's sounding more like it.
Yeah, 10 civilizations out there.
10 civilizations now. And that's just with some very minor playing around with this. And so, you know, the variables that you put in here matter a lot, but you've got to justify it. You've got a point when you just pull these numbers out of your hat, which it sounds like we're doing, but at the same time, you've heard me explaining this whole time. Why would L be 500? Because a lot of civilizations may go back to being radio dark because they don't need to broadcast everywhere at once anymore. Maybe the number of Earth of life sustainable planets is 7 instead of 1.3. You know, and maybe most star systems out there have a, you know, not only have an Earth-like planet, but have more than one potentially habitable life-sustaining planet. Maybe intelligent life is actually pretty common. It pops up. If you get life, you get intelligent life. And so maybe FI is something along the order of, that's the big one. If it's just 0.1, all of a sudden you're at 6 civilizations with no other changes. So this is where you get a lot of people scoffing at the Drake equation, though, is because they're sitting here going, well, you can put anything you want in there. Yeah, technically, you're right. I could put anything I want in there. But that's where we've got to get down and go, but why? Why would I pick that number? And I hope you've seen by me explaining why I chose these numbers that I did. You get some feel for what I mean by you got to explain why. You can throw anything you want in it, but why did you throw that particular thing in it?
Right.
And so this is then gets us to the actual topic today. The Drake equation is important for the Fermi paradox because with somewhat reasonable results, I hope you'll agree I put in some somewhat reasonable numbers in there.
Seems reasonable to me.
We got 0.6. So we're it. There's the answer. We're it. But what are some of the other answers? Because that's not too interesting, is it?
It's interesting to me, but okay. others may feel differently. So.
So let's look at some of the other possible answers to the Fermi paradox. And I've already touched on a few of these, but life or intelligence may simply be rare. One or the other, okay? Not meaning both. Well, if life is rare, then intelligence is rare. But maybe life is something that happens once in a million or even a billion times. In which case, we're not going to find even microbes out there anywhere. But, you know, at the same time, we've got all these extremophiles here on Earth. These, deep ocean critters that live around those volcanic vents and some that are in cold water that live up around what are called methane gas seeps that come up out of the bottom of the ocean. And you've got life that lives around these things. You've got life that lives in the hydrothermal vents that are in the Yellowstone, you know, where supposedly it's too acidic or it's too hot or it's too this. Life shouldn't exist there, there it is.
Didn't they take some microbes up to the International Space Station and expose them to vacuum and without radiation shielding, and they survived?
Depends on the type of bacteria, but yes, that's something that can happen. We've done experiments with that here on Earth, even. Pardon.
So if that stuff can survive in vacuum, it could it potentially move from planet to planet?
How?
Well,
you've asked a very good question, but the problem is it's got to be blown off the planet in a pretty violent
scenario. Well, that's what I was going to say. An asteroid hits a rocky planet and this happens to hit a patch of this stuff. It gets blown off. It orbits the sun and then lands on another planet where it can thrive. And I've heard that called the seeding theory.
Seeding, panspermia.
Panspermia, that's it. Do you subscribe to that? Do you think it's possible? What are your thoughts on that?
My thoughts are that my decision is on hold. Gotcha. Let's find life somewhere else. If we do, life at that point becomes relatively common in my mind. Mm-hmm. And the possibility that it gets blown off one world, survives that impact somehow, then insists and survives flying through space for no telling how long, then survives going through an atmosphere where the outer layers of the asteroid were ablated, survives the impact, and now it can spread in a more congenial environment.
A lot of ifs.
That becomes a lot more possible when you've got episode 2. Because I will also point out is if it's that common a thing, then one, why haven't we found these signs of these bacterial cysts in meteorites? And why don't we occasionally just have, pop, here's a new type of life popping up on Earth? You see what I'm saying?
Right, I got you.
It can't be that common, but at the same time, once we find life 2.0, it becomes a lot more plausible, and I'm willing to sit there and say, yes, this happens. So,
okay,
I'm waiting to answer this question right here. How common is life?
Right, gotcha.
And once we know that, now the gates are open, and it becomes, honestly, a lot even more fun to speculate at that point, because holy cow, does that open the floodgates. All right.
The great filter. What is this great filter?
The great filter. The great filter is not a singular thing. Mm-hmm. The great filter is called such because there are several places where people have identified that life could get bottlenecked, that it could be choked out and choked down and kept in its current state, or it could be extinguished, or it could be just, that's as good as it gets. And so there's a filter that you have to get through before you can progress on. Examples of great filters may be life forming in the first place. Okay? Mm-hmm. If you can't get life formed, it's kind of hard to get intelligence. End of process. You're filtered out.
Right.
Okay? Number two, life on Earth went through a great filter. We know this for a fact, because early life on Earth did not use oxygen in its respiration and its energy production. Oxygen was, in fact, a deadly gas. And life proliferated and proliferated, started producing oxygen, putting it in the atmosphere. And as long as there was iron in the ocean water and on the land for that oxygen to quickly combine with, everything was fine. The oxygen levels didn't rise. But once the oxygen level in the atmosphere started actually rising because of the poop of these early forms of bacteria, it nearly killed itself off. So that's a great filter. Life nearly killed itself because it pooped itself out of existence. There just happened to be a few aerobic bacteria that used oxygen to produce energy. And they took over because, hey, I've got this oxygen-rich environment now.
So we breathe poop gas to live.
We breathe death gas.
Death gas.
I like calling it that way, thanks to a writing prompt I saw on Facebook or on Reddit. I can't remember where I originally saw it. But it basically called us the death breathers. That the other, getting ahead on this very discussion, the other civilizations out there are leaving us alone because you leave the death breathers alone, because oxygen is truly some nasty stuff. These free radicals that are you hear about that are what causes aging and destroy our bodies. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're talking about oxygen. That's what a free radical is. This is an oxygen ion. And, you know, look what oxygen does to wood.
End of metal.
When you apply enough heat to wood first, you burn it. So you are a slow burning log. It just takes you 70 years, 80 years to be consumed. But oxygen is nasty, 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 nasty stuff. It combines readily with everything. And so it may very well be that there's only us out here in space that breathe out of this vile gas and actually survive on it. And that may put us in a very unique position. Do as we wish. We will release the death gas on you.
All right, now calm down, mad scientist supervillain.
All right. Other great, getting on, moving along a little bit. Other possible great filters are going from prokaryotic, I believe it is, prokaryotic to eukaryotic cells, mm-hmm. and from there to getting to multicellular life in the first place. Because if it's all bacteria, what real impetus do they have to get together and form a much more organized organism? Mm-hmm. You know, lose their own individuality and ability to survive and give it up so that they can form this more complex thing. So multicellular life is potentially a great filter. All right. So the other aspect of the great filter is, and this is the one most people try to focus on, is you get intelligence, you get life, you get intelligence. How likely is that intelligence to blow itself up? And so that's where a lot of people come into going, the great filter is, you know, how likely you are to survive a nuclear war. That's definitely in there, but it's only part of the picture. Okay? So then another answer to this Fermi paradox, survival is rare. Okay? Global warming, nuclear war, period. Pollution. I mean, we were poisoning ourselves before the EPA came out. You know?
Unchecked.
Pumping our
pandemics.
Air full of toxins. Huh?
Unchecked pandemics.
You know? So it doesn't have to be war or a particular type of war. We're our own biggest enemy all the way around. Okay? So the other thing is, maybe it's too far away to contact. Remember, if there's only six of us around, the galaxy, our galaxy is 100,000 light years across. That's a large volume to scatter six potential communicatees around. We may simply be too far away to even notice each other.
Who was it that said that the we live in a unremarkable around an unremarkable star in the backwoods of the galaxy? Was that Carl Sagan? Did Dr. Sagan say that?
I it may have been Dr. Sagan. I'm not 100% on that. I've heard it. I've heard it bandied about. It is not an unreasonable thing to say, except I would take issue with it being an unremarkable star. G stars like our sun are very common. But that's what makes them remarkable. If we're looking for life, where do we want to look? Where we know life has happened. And so that makes G stars actually pretty remarkable. But they're unremarkable in that they are fairly common. You know, the O, A, and B stars are big and flashy and bright and all of this type of stuff, but you know, they don't make up the majority of the galaxy. The majority of the galaxy is made up by GK and M stars. So our sun and lower. Mm-hmm. So, it's not an unreasonable statement. I just take a little exception with it. And the fact that if you're looking for life, look where you know it exists. So, yeah, we're back to things are too far away to contact. You know, I should have looked it up. I don't know how far away our nearest G-star relative is, but I do know how far away the Orion Nebula is, which is a star-forming region, and that's about 800 light-years away. So think about it this way. That's eight, if we saw reason to send a signal towards a star in the Orion nursery, it would take 800 years for the signal to get there. And if anybody was listening and caught the signal and said, oh, hey, they're saying hello. Well, hey, guys, we're here, too. It's now 800 years for their return hello.
Assuming they understand us and to begin with and don't have to take 10 or 20 years or 100 years to figure out our language.
Right. And so at a minimum, you just had 1600 years travel time for that signal. And so if we were listening in again on the return and it's like, huh, nobody, not only is nobody alive who remembers sending the signal, you know, nobody who sent the signal is no longer alive, but nobody's alive who even remembers sending the signal. That's what I was trying to say.
Right.
You know, the people who sent the signal are definitely dead. In fact, anybody who might remember that the signal was sent is dead. So, you know, it would start the process all over again. Hey, we just got a signal. They're saying hello.
And of course, the people on the other planet might be dead as well. So it's like this random hello keeps bouncing back and forth across the light years. And no one knows anything what's going on. It's just
hello, hello,
hello, hello, hello, hello.
You're getting the idea.
That would be just, that'd be hilarious.
That would be hilarious and depressing at the same time, but not so depressing as the next point, but you've got something you wanted to say, so go ahead.
No, I was just thinking in my mind, you know, what if like the Enterprise in Star Trek, like finds a signal and investigates both planets and they're like, they're just saying hello to each other and hundreds of years are passing. Let's just leave them alone.
Well, and Star Trek by the Prime Directive would have to.
Right. Well, I'm just saying it's just they're just saying hello to each other. It's, you know, whatever, you know. So I don't know. I just think it would be funny.
On the Prime Directive, how many times did Star Trek throw it out the window and say, ah, heck with that. It was a good idea.
Yeah, that's true. That's true, especially if the aliens were good-looking women. All right,
right,
we're being watched isolated. Let's talk about that.
Okay. This one comes into, and this one certainly is going to tickle a lot of our UFO watchers out there. This one says that we can't find them because we're being intentionally watched and isolated. We're the Truman Show?
Yeah, yeah.
Of the galaxy. You know, or maybe it is like Star Trek with the Vulcans passing by every now and then going, have they discovered warp technology yet? No. Okay. And going on, you know, maybe we're being watched and isolated until we show some sign that says they're worth contacting now.
I saw a cartoon that said this alien was talking to another alien on the screen. It says, this planet is weird, Bert. Last month they lobotomized pumpkins, and this month they're worshiping birds. So,
right. So
we may just be too weird to contact.
We may be too weird. We may be their highest rated reality TV show. You know, they may be waiting for some sign that we're worth contacting. They could be deciding what to do with us. You know, if they're a galactic empire out there and we're death gas breathers, what do you do with this planet? We can't exactly colonize it because death gas. But at the same time, do we just leave these death gas breathers there to eventually find their way out to the stars and become a problem?
That's a cheery thought.
You know, so there's a cheery thought, you know. We live in an environment they can't use. So they have no need to wreak havoc among us. But at the same time, you know, do we do with them?
Would it be difficult for them to alter our atmosphere in a way that they could use it and we would die off? I mean, we're doing a good job doing that ourselves, I think, but I mean, so could an outside agency fire a few missiles or something and change the oxygen to something else?
You answered your own question. We're doing a pretty good job of ourselves, because not only is climate changing, but the ratio of the gases, the partial pressure of the gases, is changing. Okay. Our lungs don't operate at a 21% oxygen level. They actually are designed and work at a particular partial pressure of oxygen. In other words, the atmosphere itself as a whole gives off a pressure here at sea level of around 15 pounds per square inch.
Mm-hmm.
Part of that pressure is due to the oxygen, the O2 level. It's that partial pressure of O2 that has to be at a certain point, or you can't breathe properly anymore. At 10,000 feet, we pressurize our cabins. Why? Not because there's less oxygen. It's still 21% oxygen. But because that partial pressure of oxygen has now dropped below a point where our lungs work efficiently. So it's also a matter of, if the ratio of that, the gases gets messed up too much, and that partial pressure drops of oxygen drops too low, bam, we can't breathe. Plenty of oxygen in the atmosphere, but we can't breathe it. We're gasping for breath. And so there's things like that that can be done. You don't have to remove the oxygen. You just got to mess up the pressures, the partial pressures a little bit. Put more of one type of gas than the other in there. And, you know, all sorts of neat things that can happen. You know, and then I recently read a story about this. Then there's the whole possibility of releasing a virus that doesn't necessarily kill off the population, because, you know, maybe they do have some qualms about extinguishing, you know, making the death breathers extinct. We probably should, but let's just keep them bottled up there. So we're going to release this virus that attaches to their neurons and slows down their development. They can't think as quickly. They get tired easily and all of this stuff. So, you know,
if you're not careful, you're going to spawn some conspiracy theories on the show. So be careful where you're going with that, okay?
Yeah. You know, maybe we're suffering from the great malady where these aliens are gassing us or dosing us with this neurological agent that just makes it where we don't have the drive, the enough and go to get out there into space. You know, to figure things out where we can do it.
Okay, listen, again, no conspiracy theories are being created on this show, okay?
Who knows? Maybe. Maybe it's being done from within.
Okay, let's move on. We're one of the first. We are the Vorlons.
So this is one gets back to my Drake values of the Drake equation, 0.6.
Mm-hmm.
We're one of the first. Okay. I have a lot of reasons for this being my favorite answer to the Fermi paradox. You know, 0.6 civilizations possible in 500 year span of the lifetime of one. So why would that be my first and go-to choice on this? There's another problem that is oftentimes not discussed in this, and that to get life, at least life as we know it, you need these heavier elements on the periodic table. By heavy elements, I'm an astronomer, so light elements are hydrogen and helium. Anything heavier than helium is a heavy element. Okay? So you need these heavy elements like carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, iron, copper. You need these elements to be able to get life going in the first place. Actually, you need them just to you need silicon to have a rocky planet to stand on. Okay? So where did those elements come from? Well, the Big Bang produced pretty much hydrogen, helium, and a tiny little amount of lithium and beryllium.
You broke up there for a second. Little bit of something, beryllium?
Lithium and beryllium.
Okay. Go ahead.
Okay. Most of our lithium and beryllium that we have around today is made from cosmic ray impacts. But, you know, the Big Bang made a little bit. Everything heavier than that, then, has to have been made through some form of nucleosynthesis. It has to have come from stars. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
It has to have come from little stars like our sun, puffing out their gas envelopes, and there's various processes that go on in that create some of the heavier elements. It could be massive stars going kaboom and blowing off their outer layers, which are filled with carbon and so forth. It could be two neutron stars merging, producing gold and uranium and things like that. Okay? Mm-hmm. The bottom line is all of these heavy elements had to have been made in stars, which means Earth can't be a first population star. Population zero, I think it's population zero. I've forgotten them reversed. Anyway, Earth, and since the sun and hence Earth, had to have been around, couldn't have been created until after a few generations of stars had lived and died, creating and then churning up all of these heavier elements into the galactic plane where they could be incorporated into stars like our sun. So what I'm trying to get at is when was there enough of these heavy elements created and then mixed in that you could get an Earth-like planet? And the answer is about the time that our sun formed. So this idea that there's ancient civilizations a billion years older than Earth, no, they really aren't. Not unless you can figure out a way to make hydrogen and helium think.
Okay.
So there are no civilizations a billion years older than we are. Okay. Not unless there's some really ridiculous fluke happened. Chances are there are no civilizations that are more than a million or 2 years in advance of us at all. So again, we're back to, don't go looking for the elder civilizations. We're the elder civilization. You know, are we necessarily the oldest? Probably not, but we're in the front running. And so, you know, no, I don't believe we're going to get out there. I am an optimist. I believe we will end up as a species getting out into space. I am a pessimist. I don't believe we'll be doing it by FTL means and forming a galactic empire. But I do believe we'll get out there, and I believe our descendants will be finding planets, not with, you know, a question, you know, right. The city at the edge of forever type stuff.
Right.
They'll be finding barren planets with life on it, and maybe a few low-tech civilizations, but overall, we'll be the Vorlons, yes, and the Shadow. And which we will be, I think we'll be determined on it by each ship.
That's a cheery thought.
Isn't it, though? But,
so this goes to this next point, that there is no one else. Or are you saying that we're it and we're a single life form?
Right. And that's that's the flip side of the coin. I'm saying we're one of the elder.
Okay.
I'm saying there are other civilizations that are with us out there right now, but I'm saying, we're, like you were saying at the beginning of that discussion, yes, we're the Vorlons, we're the Shadows, we're the what is it from the fifth element? Begins with an M.
I know, I don't, I'm blanking on the name, but take your point. That
the big aliens in the bulky suits.
Yeah. Are you Germans? Aziz, light!
Light!
Such a great film. If you have not seen The Fifth Element, please turn us off and go watch it right now. It is a fine film. It's great. Bruce Willis, I forget the young lady's name that was in it. but it's a great film. Go see it.
Great film. It's got what's his name in it?
Chris Tucker.
Plays Zorg.
Gary Oldman. Gary Oldman, yes. I was about to say Gary Busey, but I know that's not right. So
Gary Oldman in it. Zorg.
Absolutely wonderful film. We're getting off topic.
Yep. So the flip side of that is that we're one of the first, is that there is nobody else.
Mm-hmm.
And that is an answer to the Fermi paradox that always must be broached. The answer really could be as simple as we are it. There will be no others. There are no others. We're it. Now, in our galaxy, that's to me is not a far-fetched idea.
Really?
As we went through with the Drake equation, it could very well prove that it is rare that life takes hold, and it is even rarer that intelligent life takes hold. So, within our galaxy, where you've only got 3 stars per year being born, right on down the list, it would not be surprising. It would not surprise me. It would disappoint. It would not surprise me if we're it. In the universe, that we're the only ones, I mean, it's like I said, the Milky Way galaxy has 200 to 300 billion stars.
Mm-hmm.
There are more than that. There are more galaxies in the universe that we can see than that number of stars. Each of them with that number of stars. So telling me that we're the only civilization, intelligent civilization in the universe, quite frankly, I'm going to kind of smirk and, yeah, okay, whatever. Okay, and go on my merry. I'm not going to argue with you. You're wrong. Okay? But in our galaxy, it's not. It wouldn't surprise me. Disappoint me. Yes. But, you know, between the great filters, between, you know, how rare is intelligence to develop, and more importantly, the tool using to communicate with, you've got an issue of we may be it. Will we be the only one ever? That leans a little more towards the universe question. That takes a certain amount of credulity that I don't have. I think there may be others after us.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, we may be the only one right now, for certain. So that's disappointing for a lot of very people to hear, I know, but it is certainly a possibility that must be taken into account and acknowledged.
Do you think in the this goes more to the evolution thing, but you know, in early life there was the dinosaurs and invertebrates and so forth, then the rise of hominids. Do you think then after us it will be like the insects, like cockroaches and stuff will be the next group of, you know, the mammals became intelligent, then the insects become the next race to dominate the earth?
No.
I don't think I'm asking the question the right way, but
if I'm figuring out what you're asking, I have to answer no.
Mm-hmm.
The insects have ruled the world only for one time, and that was fairly early on, life moving out of the seas.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That said, the insects were the first ones. Insect and arthropods were the first ones to move on to land.
Right.
Then came the amphibians. Then came the more dominant species was actually mammal-like reptiles. Things like Dimetrodon and Edaphosaurus and individuals like that. Mm-hmm. These were actually mammal-related reptiles. They were still reptiles, but they had a lot of mammalian like dental structures and so forth, and in fact are our ancient ancestors. Then a mass extinction happened and the dinosaurs took over. So since the amphibians lost their dominance way back when,
mm-hmm.
the Earth's dominant species has either been mammal or mammal-like, or the dinosaurs, reptiles.
Mm-hmm.
So my view is if we kick things off to the point where it's we make enough of a mess of things that we mammals can't hold on to the dominant position, I do truly believe it will be the dinosaurs, birds, and other reptiles that take back over. There's no clear line yet on what makes it, whereas, you know, with these mass extinctions, which species survive. We've got some good feel. I heard one of them, one scientist put it as, the key criteria is weediness, you know, as in plant weeds.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to be everywhere. You've got to be able to adapt to change really quickly. And a few more criteria that when you think about it, yeah, that's weeds. And so, you know, there's that. Personally, I don't think humans are going anywhere for a long time.
Despite climate change?
Yeah, climate change, I don't think, is going to matter a whole hill of beans. Really? Will our civilization survive? Absolutely not. Okay. Mm. Will humans survive? You got to remember, there's 8 billion of us. Okay. If you did a 99% wipe of humanity, you would still leave 1%, which 1% of 8 billion is still 80 million.
Well, that's true.
Okay. That's still more people than were in medieval Europe.
Okay.
All right. So people ask me, you know, are we going to drive ourselves to extinction? Probably not. You know, because it would pretty much take a life-ending event. Life itself is completely obliterated to get rid of us at this point. When you add in how clever a critter we are, you know, I mean, we may become Morlocks living underground and growing everything hydroponically and such as that, but we'll survive it. The question is just what form our civilization and our species will take to achieve that survival, but we'll survive. You know, so that's why, you know, for me, one of the big questions is there an earth-shattering kaboom coming? You know, is there a big asteroid with our name on it? Because short of something like that, that literally puts the entire biosphere in danger,
mm-hmm.
I think we're here. Nuclear war, our cancer rates go up and we keep on ticking. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, look at the deer and the wild boar in the Chernobyl area. You know?
True. And nuclear war, I mean, yeah, it'll destroy the cities and stuff, but the two cities that were destroyed, you know, in the use of nuclear weapons in war have been rebuilt and people live there.
Right.
So
I know that's a very unpopular opinion too, you know, oh, we're going to make ourselves go extinct. It could happen. I could be wrong, mm-hmm. but I don't think so. I think people drastically underestimate, one, just how many of us there are,
mm-hmm.
and therefore, two, just what level event would be required to squash that many.
Hey, Tantef. Hey, Dark Wolf. Welcome to the chat. How are you doing? Glad to see you. We're talking about the Fermi paradox. If you have any questions about it, we welcome all questions. So thanks for being
Absolutely.
Here.
Absolutely. So anyway, that's kind of a sideways issue on the Fermi paradox, because that does get into L, mm-hmm. as I mentioned, capital L. How long do civilizations live?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you're broadcasting your whole time, that's how long does your civilization itself live? And that plays into that. You know, maybe, you know, civilizations don't learn the lesson of quieting down their radio transmissions. And so they're broadcasting for 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 years. There was something I was going to say in that.
There it is.
Something on capital L, the life of civilizations. One person that I saw one time brought up the point that maybe the reason we don't hear anyone else is because there is a potential galactic empire trying to form out there. They've thrown out these drones that seek out radio signals and devour the resources of that planet to make and that solar system to make more of themselves and then go out seeking others. And that basically there's something out there that utterly destroys any civilization stupid enough to keep broadcasting. In which case, maybe we're doing the right thing of going radio dark. Maybe we're, so to speak, getting our head back down in the blind so we don't get attract attention. Maybe we don't want to be known. And so, yeah, you brought up my next point there. Civilizations go radio quiet quickly.
I saw a video recently, and I wish I could tell you who made it, but I can't. I'm drawing a blank on that. But it said that it would only take self-replicating probes about 100 million years to colonize the Milky Way galaxy.
I've heard something similar, and it does not sound far-fetched. You know, you send out 50 of these things to the nearest star. They find planets there. They build, they get enough resources to repair themselves and to build 50 more. Mm-hmm. And then now they go spread out from there. And each time they get to a system, they repair themselves and 50 more. And that's a geometric progression.
Mm-hmm.
So you very quickly cover a lot of territory and become seen if you do this.
Mm-hmm.
And so now we're back up to, if there is an elder civilization than us, why haven't we seen them? Why haven't we seen their probes? I mean, we're thinking of doing this. Hmm. You know, are we that unique? I don't know.
Maybe we are the first.
Maybe we are the first. You know, are close enough to it that we just haven't been visited by their probes yet. You know, so all of this does definitely go into this thinking, this calculation. It's definitely something you got to speculate on and go. And, you know, for anybody who doubts, that's what we're doing here. We're speculating. We're guessing. There is definitely a problem. And I hope we've conveyed that as well. If there are other intelligent civilizations out there, we should have some sign of them. And we don't. So why is that? And I'm sure we'll figure it out one way or another. You know, maybe we'll find out we're the only one in this galaxy. Or maybe we'll find out, hey, we're one of the first ones. We're the first ones out of the gate. In which case, what do we do with the others when we've come upon them? You know, do we help them out and bring them up onto the plane? Or do we keep them boxed up and save the galaxy for ourselves, or what?
Guess that depends on the kind of people we are at the time we find them.
All right.
On your screen now, you see a bunch of references for what we have covered. I'm going to leave that on the screen and let people copy them. This will be in the Discord for anyone who wants to come take a look at it. I'll put that in the chat as well. Go ahead with what you were saying there, Kissinger. I didn't mean to interrupt.
Shoot, I just kind of forgot.
Sorry.
No, it's fine. It's good to put up your references.
I have some follow-up questions, though.
Okay, sure, shoot.
All right, this is going to sound kind of confusing the way I ask it, but I think I've got it pretty clear. All right, how do we know how old the universe is if there are parts of the universe beyond the observable universe that we've never seen?
Okay.
If that makes sense.
That does make sense, and it is... it is something that's asked.
Mm-hmm.
And we do know that the universe is more extensive than what we can see.
Mm-hmm.
Because we are seeing, at the furthest we can see, we are seeing the universe as it was 13.4 billion years ago.
Right.
So it has expanded for 13.4 billion years beyond that. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So we can't see it the way it is now. So it is definitely expanded beyond our event horizon, our ability to see.
Mm-hmm.
That said, we can make no definite assertions about anything we can't see. So unless it's causing some turmoil out there at the edge, we couldn't see what was beyond. And that's a neat thing. We don't see any turmoil or turbulence or what have you, any signs of interaction with anything out at that point. So it's not like the universe is running into itself or running into anything out there. Or we'd see signs of that, and we don't. So you can take away from that one of two things. Either the universe is even more rarefied when you get out past that limit that we can see, or we're seeing the edge, we're just seeing it where it was 13.4 billion years ago. If that makes sense.
Right. So essentially, it'd be like a bubble continuously expanding, and we can see the bubble, the edge of the bubble, the membrane of the bubble, if you will.
Right.
But we can't see beyond that membrane to where the bubble is expanding.
Well, and you see, the thing is if there was, say, another bubble that it was expanding into, we'd see the change in the surface there.
Right.
Okay. If there was a wind it was blowing against, we'd see the change in the surface.
Mm.
If it were expanding into itself because it had a thick shell, we would see that change in the surface. And we don't. So the conclusion that has to be made then is that either none of those things are happening, or there's nothing out there that it's expanding against or into or any of this other stuff. And in fact, that's one of the key tricks to wrapping your head in a way around some of this cosmology stuff is you have to start thinking of space and time as actual things, as a box you can set on your table. Because at that point, you realize that the universe expanding is that you're creating more boxes. So it's not expanding into anything. It's just it's expanding because you've created more boxes.
But light is not unidirectional. It goes in all directions, right? So the farthest stars or the farthest galaxies we see are shedding light in a direction that we cannot see in.
Right.
So there could be more universe out there, right?
Could be. Probably not. It depends on which shape the universe really is. If it's flat, flat or open, as it's called, hyperbolic, then yes, there could be more stuff out there that we just can't see. And the other problem with that is it may be that there is nothing else out there, but the light would not bounce off of the edge. It would not, there'd just be no space out there for it to go into. So it'd kind of be like it just disappeared. There would be no reflection off of a wall or something. Okay.
Well, I guess what I'm asking is, couldn't there be other galaxies and other stars and so forth that they're just too far away for their light to reach us?
Yes, it's possible.
Okay.
But, you know, how likely is that? Who knows? There's no way of telling.
If we somehow discover that, the new telescope or what have you, would that throw the age of the universe into question again?
Well, we cannot see to the edge of what we know the age of the universe is.
Mm-hmm.
You can only, unless some part of our physics proves to be incorrect and makes some minor adjustment to it, because that's all that changes in physics really do. And I can get into that in another time or in a minute, depending on your preference.
Mm-hmm.
But how to put this? Basically, you could get no stars forming until about 300,000 years after the Big Bang. So since galaxies are made up of stars, there would be nothing to see until 300,000 years after the Big Bang. So you can't see actually to the edge to the Big Bang. Mm-hmm. So you can't see the age of the universe. We have a lot of other tricks we have to use to figure out what the actual age of the universe is, because we cannot see that far.
Gotcha.
I don't know how well I'm answering the question, but the bottom line is we have these other methods that, dear God, I don't really understand how they're doing them.
Mm-hmm.
But they use them, and they've determined the age of the universe. It has to do with the rate of the expansion and the curvature of space as a whole and things like that. And they've got that pretty well pinned down to 13.4 billion years. But the furthest away object we can see is only about 13 billion light years away. So there's, you know, a few hundred million years further that we should theoretically be able to see, except there's nothing there. And the reason is because it was still too hot. There is nothing there. There's no matter of any sort, really. There's free electrons and free protons, but there's nothing coming together in stars or anything like that.
Okay.
All right. kind of what the cosmic microwave background, if you've heard of it.
Mm-hmm.
That's that first light that the universe cooled down enough that zoop, you know, you've got hydrogen atoms. And now electromagnetic radiation can fly everywhere, and it's been stretched out that it's gone from gamma radiation to now it's microwave level wavelengths over the course of the 13.4 billion years.
Gotcha.
Okay.
How certain are we about any of this? Can we be completely off base about any of this?
There's always a chance we're off base about this. But to answer that question, I use Isaac Asimov's. I direct people towards Isaac Asimov's wonderful essay called "The Relativity of Wrong."
Mm-hmm.
In this, he points out to someone who asked him a question about, you know, what if science is wrong, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And he pointed out that to the ancients, the earth was flat. And of course, now we scoff at that idea, but to an approximation, the earth is flat. I mean, you've got to walk several miles to get a drop in a drop around the curve of a few inches. Okay, so it's a few inches over the course of miles. Well, that's pretty flat. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
But then we learned better with the ancient Greeks and a few other civilizations. We learned that, no, wait, things are round. And we learned the Greeks got within 20% correct accuracy of the exact of the circumference of Earth, as a matter of fact. So for using sticks and string, they did a pretty good job, got within 20%. So he went through that whole process, because even calling the Earth a sphere is wrong. But we've gone from a few inches over a mile to a few tenths of an inch over tens of miles different from a sphere. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And he just pointed out that that's the progress of science. There, you know, as earth-shaking as we try to make out that Einstein's general relativity was, all it was a refinement. If you put in the right speeds and the right, put in Earth going around the sun and everything into general relativity, you get Isaac Newton's universal law of gravity out. But Newton's law of universal gravity was demoted to being a law because it was wrong. Because it didn't predict the orbit of Mercury, the fact that its apogee precesses around the sun. Its orbit slowly is turning as well. And so what I'm getting at and driving at is some of this may prove to be wrong, But what we will find is that it's almost certainly is that it's a refinement of what we currently know. It is not an earth shaking, holy crap, everything is wrong.
Gotcha.
Anybody expecting that is expecting a unicorn. Okay.
Gotcha.
And this is why on similar topic, you know, us being visited by alien races that could travel faster than the speed of light. Why I'm very pessimistic. I scoff at that idea is because everything we know now suggests that such is either impossible or requires such huge amounts of input that we're talking, you consume stars, plural, to do it. Mm. Well, neither of those is going to happen. Well, what if we find out physics that we don't know now that allows for it? Except we're not. Because all we're going to find from here on out is refinements on what we know. We're not going to find something that just cracks it all open and says, well, we were wrong.
So you don't subscribe to the theory of wormholes or the hypothesis of wormholes, I should say?
Wormholes present a whole crap load of problems. They probably exist. But they are probably unstable. They are almost certainly impossible to direct. And to try to open one up on your own would take the existence of something called negative mass. Well, when you figure out what negative mass is and what it does, go win your Nobel Prize. Because that will be something that, again, refines physics, but at the same time does kind of crack it open. But it cracks it open in the matter that it leads to in a different direction, not that it utterly shatters. Wormholes do exist, but the problem is they're not controllable. And again, negative matter proves to exist, it would still take a tremendous amount of energy on the order of a star to open one, control one, and send traffic through.
Gotcha.
Well, I don't see a civilization spending a star every time they want to transport, you know, material from one planet to another. I hate to burst people's bubbles in a way, but at the same time, it's like, yeah, this stuff really isn't going to happen, folks.
Well, yeah, I was going to, it's okay. I was going to ask you about the cosmic speed limit and do you think we'll ever solve it? You just answered that question. So,
It's the speed of light.
right. And we'll never get past it, at least not now with our current understanding. Right. Those adjustments might get us there eventually, but not today. So
not today. And that's what I'm basing my statements on. I'm very pessimistic because, you know, I would speculate all day long and twice on Sunday if there was something on the horizon. Hey, we could see some crack in general relativity that indicates maybe there's something there, but there's just not. General relativity is right up there with quantum mechanics and evolution as being one of the most documented evidentiary theories we've come up with yet. People can they say that all they want. You're wrong. Okay. You're wrong. Sorry. We're done.
Okay.
So, you know, the one hope I do hold out for going faster than light is a very risky proposition, and that is that there are higher order dimensions, as in length, height, width, time. There are higher orders of those in which point A and point B are closer together, and you can slide through them. The hyperspace idea. Okay. My problem with hyperspace is it would be the math involved in solving those equations that basically would take you out of our universe, take you outside of it, and then drop you back in to hit where and when you wanted. Okay. Notice I say where and when you wanted to go would just be mind boggling at this point. We don't have a human, much less a supercomputer that can handle those types of calculations. And you want me to jump in a ship and press go. Who knows where the hell I'm coming out at or when. And who knows how or when I'll ever figure out how to get back.
Well, it just sounds like an adventure, doesn't it? I'm going on an adventure.
Sounds like a one-way trip to me.
But what a trip, you know?
Okay, I won't disagree there, but you know, hyperspace might be an answer to get around things, and I do like the Star Trek idea of the warp drive, because general relativity does not prescribe that space can't go faster than light. You just cannot go faster than light while occupying space. So in other words, you could theoretically possibly warp space around yourself and accelerate that space that you occupy to faster than light speed relative to the rest of the universe. And that's the idea behind Star Trek's warp drive. And that might be possible. We've got some hints that it could be, but again, it's energy prohibitive. It's on the order of, you know, you're consuming stars to make a trip.
Right.
And, you know, so maybe we'll get some tweaks and refinements on down the road that maybe there is a shortcut. But as of right now, this moment, I've got no positive outlook for you.
Gotcha. All right. Are there any questions from the chat? Go ahead with what you're saying.
I was just going to comment that still doesn't mean I don't think we should be getting out there. I think we should definitely be looking in terms of generation ships. Mm-hmm. Definitely should be looking in terms of cryogenics or other preservationist type methods. You know, maybe we could get wetware to the point that we can upload ourselves into a machine body and take care of our offspring while we're on the trip to a new planet. But in the end, there's no federation of planets being formed by this. There's just us spreading out through the universe, being the human race.
Could we become capsuleers?
I've seen nothing in the biology that does not suggest that we could not do that as well. I see some moral and ethical issues with being capsuleers, because what happens to the mind and the life force of that clone you grew when you download yourself into it?
Well, there's that as well.
Right. So you've got a moral and an ethical issue there. Well, we lobotomized it before we while it was growing. Right. That makes it so much better. <You
know>? Yeah, it's kind of a gray area, isn't it?
Yes. Now, if you're talking Eve capsuleers.
Yeah, that's what I was really
no, there's no gray area. Fuck them.
No, that's true.
I've got the ISK.
Here's my 900,000 ISK. Give me my new body, damn it.
Right.
So,
all right. But we could end up being like the Borg fairly easily. And that, you know, we could end up being brains in a jar, if you will, or even getting our electronics to the point that we upload a brain, a mind, into an electronic mind. So
that's still an uncomfortable prospect. Now, if I could become like a data like android, you know, my mind right. in a, you know, positronic net, you know, that wouldn't be bad. I can design right. the body exactly the way I want it. It could look exactly the way I want it. Have the abilities exactly the way I want. You know, if I could do that, I'm all for that, because leaving this behind would be, you know,
I'm all for leaving the meat behind.
Yeah, me too.
You know, I am all about leaving the meat.
All right, let's any other topics we want to cover?
I have no idea.
Any questions, you know, from the chat? I will
spitball and speculate with anybody, but we've had nothing from the peanut gallery.
All right, let's go ahead and move on. Now, you have taken a break from the streaming thing for a bit now.
Yeah.
I hope you get back into streaming. I would love to see your Skyrim streams. I would love to see your Hero Game streams. I kind of really want to see, you know, still kind of want you to come over to World of Warcraft and do the hardcore challenge with me, if you wanted to do that. So I think that would be fun. Yep. All right. My next stream will be Monday night, 7 p.m. I'm returning to World of Warcraft Hardcore. I'm going to continue with my Night Elf Priest. We'll see how far she gets. I wanted to mention that on December 18th, this very show will be having its season finale for season one. And our season premiere will for our second season will be January 8th, 2022. I hope you join us on both episodes. We have some things planned, and hopefully it will all work out. And if we're lucky, we'll have a guest on the 18th, and that will be exciting. So, and we have a great idea for a topic of discussion about the education system. And so please consider joining us for that on December 18th. I want to thank Kesadrith for being here. I want to thank Tantiv and Darkwolf for popping in and saying hello. Everyone else in the chat who popped in but didn't say anything, all the lurkers and views, thank you so much for being here. Anything further, Kesadrith?
No. I don't really have a whole lot to say, so, you know.
Right. I want to thank you all for being here. If you see this on YouTube, it will be put on YouTube after we turn off. Please like and subscribe. Hit the bell button down there on YouTube. If you liked what you see here on Twitch, please consider hitting the follow button. And again, I want to remind you about our support of Rain and the discounts for being a subscriber in the merchant store, the merch store. 10% for tier 1, 20% for tier 2, and 50% for tier 3 subscribers in the merch store. So get you a Wondergoon mug and drink your coffee or your favorite beverage, your rumquila, as I was recently informed that that's a thing. So buy Tantiv and Darkwolf, and it's exactly what it sounds like, rum and tequila together. Wow, what a way for me to kill myself.
Indeed. Yeah. Waste a good rum.
All right. My name is Wondergoon. His name is Kesadrith.
Hi, everybody. Good night, everybody.
We'll see you next time on the Midnight Stream to Nowhere. Y'all have a great night. Thank you.